Pauper Players Podcast. I'm Frusile, and thank you so much for joining me. If this is your first time joining me, the philosophy of this podcast is to speak to the players who are shaping the metagame so that their voices can be heard. This week's voices join us from Italy. AdeptoTerra just top-rated the challenge with Tron. It'll be his first time joining us. After conversing with him, we'll open a dialogue with Modern Monkey, last week's challenge winner, whom has joined us before. When he did previously, we learned about Pauper in Italian culture. But this time around, he won the challenge, and we're going to instead learn from these two guests about the Italian flavor of Tron. So please do enjoy a slightly different structure this week. Thanks so much for coming on the podcast. Can you tell me a bit about yourself?
Hello, Pauper Players. I'm AdeptoTerra. My real-life name is Alessandro Moretti. My nickname is a reference to Golden Sun, a Game Boy Advance video game. I'm a 25 years older part-time worker, and I'm also an Italian content creator. I wrote a lot of articles, in, mostly in Italian. I published a few videos on YouTube, and sometimes I'm streams on Twitch.
Can you share how you started playing Magic the Gathering?
I started playing Magic at 11 years old because my group of friends, which I used to play Pokemon on Game Boy, started playing Magic. So me too, initially playing only for fun, and I played for something like 2 years. Then I took a hiatus until the end of the high school. And then I started playing again Magic, just for curiosity. After 1 year, while playing first Standard, then Modern, I started playing Pauper, and I find it really a really enjoyable format.
What brought you to Pauper, and what made you stick with it?
The first time I see something related to Pauper was 5 or 6 years ago on the internet, while reading various topics in the Italian forum metagame, I noticed the only common format because there was an explosion of interest in that format at that time. My first deck was Hordes of Aristocrats, basically a slower version of the Golgari Aristocrats, and I was fascinated to the mechanics, the archetypes, and the vast only common format. I think that there's two reasons to play a format. The first, you are able to find a deck you enjoy to play. The second is you actually enjoy the world format. For me, that's both, because I can find really enjoyable to play decks like Elves Blue, Delver's decks, also Flicker Tron. There's also some interesting combos decks, like for example Charles Tribe or Esper Familiar. Actually, I really enjoy the Pauper format because most of the games are really skill intensive. You are able to play certain aggro strategies, and you need skill to win against problematic matchup. You are able to play midrange or control or also combo, and you need skill to win. Another aspect that I really appreciate about the Pauper format is the incremental advantage you need to try to steal the game. Often you don't have any game breaker single cards. Yeah, there's actually cards like the Monarch, I mean Palace Sentinel and Turn of the Black Rose, or some mass removals against aggro strategies are able to destroy an entire strategy and gameplay, but usually there's no that problem and you can enjoy the whole game while trying to win until the last turn.
Could you tell me about the unwind in your list?
Unwind is probably my favorite counter spell. I started playing it since the print in Dominaria. I previously ran the singleton copy of this spell in the Robotron in the main deck, and then when they printed it, I say, wow, that card is really amazing, because it's basically the singleton copy of a specific counter that I often use just to counter the opponent removal spells targeting my flicker lock. And I think that is a really huge tempo advantage, because it allows me to counter the opponent removal spells and then untapping enough colored mana to play Ghostal Flicker on the Ephemerate or Ephemerate and bring back the Answer, I mean the counterspell, the Unwind or any other counter, and then eventually play an Impulse or a Flicker targeting a Mold Drifter just to dig more in the in my deck and be able to find other combo pieces, lock pieces, or any kind of card I need.
Reign of Revelation is also unique.
The big problem about the card advantage in Tron, in my opinion, is not really having a late game card, an instant late game card that allows you to get more card advantage. Because usually the most important card in Tron is Mold Drifter, also because it's a card advantage card and a finisher. It's a real win condition, Mold Drifter. And sometimes when you are not able to blink a Mold Drifter, or you didn't draw any Mold Drifter in maybe the first half of the game, you need an instant card, fetchable card with mystical teachings that grant you to draw enough card to dig in your deck, and often Forbidden Alchemy, you don't really want to cast a lot of Forbidden Alchemy, because anytime you cast a Forbidden Alchemy, you are literally wasting some cards, because there's the eventuality to die from auto-decking, because if you draw a lot of cards, you just die. And for Reign of Revelation is just better Forbidden Alchemy if you are in a late stage of the game and be able to play Impulse. That means you can cut Forbidden Alchemy from your deck, and you are not really missing the card advantage given you by the flashback cost, because you have an alternative card advantage instant spell.
The Ulamog's Crushers in your sideboard, are they only for the mirror, or do you use them against other decks as well?
Ulamog's Crusher is primarily an alternative win condition against Boros Monarch. You may think that it's a better card, it's a card for the mirror match, but often you don't really need in the mirror match. I say that it's good against Boros Monarch because that kind of mid-range strategies, often they have a lot of hit cards, Relic of Progenitus, Pyroblast, sometimes Ukiba Gang Shinobi. So you need an alternative win condition, and Ulamog's Crusher is good because they usually need to make some room to bring in Relics, Pyroblast, and Journey to Nowhere is not really good because you are playing two copies of the Nova Horror at least. So if they kept the Journey to Nowhere to exile, Ulamog's Crusher is often good for you because you can bounce it with the Nova Horror. Anyway, if they don't have any Journey to Nowhere, they need to waste two copies of Galvanic Blast at least to kill him. Eventually, it allows you to slightly change your gameplay and be a more aggressive deck. It's similar to Monastery Mentor in other formats, I mean Modern and probably also Legacy. You can see often Monastery Mentor in the UV control, blue-white control deck sideboard. And they usually board in against decks they need to be more faster. In Flickertron case, you bring in Lumos Crusher when you need to go faster or when you need a non-interactive creature or a non-interactive finisher.
Now, you make content for both Twitch and I believe you write articles. How long have you been doing these things?
I started writing articles maybe 4 or 5 years ago for a store blog, Daltenda, an Italian store that tried to get more visualizations, more sellings with a site similar to Star City Games, Channel Fireball. I started with Pauper because at that time I was really interested in Pauper and I started writing articles for fun, trying to creating something that was not present in the Italian content. And maybe 1 or 2 years ago, I started with YouTube and Twitch because after sometimes you don't really have enough idea on what you want to write and maybe you don't want to write anymore because it's funny changing the way you are able to create content. Probably recording game VODs is more funnier, and Twitch is also streaming on Twitch is also more funnier because you can interact with the Twitch chat. For Pauper, we need more content creators because if we see the other format, there's a lot of content creators, a lot of streamers, both in Italian both, and in English. In Pauper, probably we don't have a lot of Italian content creators, but anyway, in my opinion, there's not enough English creators. Well, actually, the content creators we have in Pauper, they are really, really good, I think. But having more content creators is just better because we can create more interaction, we can create more funny content and interesting, we can make the proper format just better. Content creators are necessary to improve the quality of the format. I have actually two favorite decks in Pauper. First is Elves. Elves is one of my first two decks in Pauper. The other is Flickertron. I started with the Robotron in 2017. The first tournament that I played the Robotron was Pauper Italian Cup. The Pauper National with 70-80 players, and I finished the second, losing to Boros Monarch because it was the first time playing the deck, and I played slightly bad. Also, after playing 8 rounds in a paper tournament, so it was slightly hard for me. It was really fun for me finding out my opponent, bouncing back to your lands with General Horror. Yeah, maybe I'm a bad person for that, but I enjoy playing Prison deck, combo deck. We can actually say that also Elves is a combo deck because if we talk about the Patrick, the Innovator, Chapin macro archetypes, Elves is a storm deck. Well, you can say that Timberwatch Elf is a grip shot, Lethal Enant Master is a empty Dolores, and Distant Melody is basically an ad nauseam. So I think that not...
Can you tell me about what you played against en route to top 8ing the challenge this last week?
On Sunday, in the previous Pauper challenge, I played against Flicker Tron. I played against Fog Tron. So in the first round, I played against Elves, losing both game 1 and game 2. Probably Elves is still a bad matchup for Tron because it can kill me a lot faster than other aggressive strategies, because for Tron, any deck that can kill him before the fourth turn, it may be problematic. Also Elves, having cards like Harsh Sustenance, Kerak's Torch, and Riddle Longbow, it can kill you without combat damage. I played then against Burn, Dimir Ponza, Fogatron, and other Elves. Blue-Black Angler Delver, played by Jacob Brando. He also streamed it. Maybe it's still available, the video, on their Twitch channel. And in the final round on the Swiss, I played against Boris Bully. And in the quarters, I lost to Burn. So my thought about this matchup is simply, Burn is a deck that may be problematic for Tron, because it can, as mentioned earlier, for Elves, it can kill you on turn 4. But the biggest problem is that if you are playing a Fogatron version, you are playing a lot of cards against aggressive strategies that relies on combat damage to kill you. Burn try to kill you with non-combat damage, with creatures that deals damage directly to you, I mean Thermal Alchemist, and with burn spells that are lightning balls, that are a lot of copies of lightning balls. So the main plan against Burn is just having... The best gameplay against Burn is having enough removal spells to kill their Thermal Alchemist and Firebrand Archer, and enough counter spells to counter 4-5 burn spells, and then striking a copy or two of Bulsome Arrasa, then they are on the top deck. They can't win because you draw more cards than them. And if you have a Mnemonic Wheel, you can bring back Bulsome Arrasa. And if you have two copies of Mnemonic Wheel or an Ephemerate, you can bring back a lot of Pulse of Mirage. Burn was historically, for my previous list of Tron, Dirawa Tron or Temur list with Fire and Ice, a good matchup, because I had the green, blue, green mana base, I had removal spells, so casting Pulse of Mirage on turn 3 or turn 4 was enough to kill them. Right now, without specific life gain, is a bit problematic matchup. For that reason, I started including in my sideboard two copies of Lone Missionary. I barely copied this slot from Elsa's list, and hey, it works. Probably the other matchups I faced in the challenge, besides Burn and Elves, are really good matchup for Tron right now. That's interesting, the matchup against Punta strategies, against Land Denial, because if you add enough lands, if you add enough pulse, if you are able to draw a Pulse of Mirage in the first stage on the match, you are actually able to win them casting a lot of Pulse of Mirage. So that's what happened in that match in the challenge. Because on game 1 against Blue Black Punza, I think I had casted something like 12 copies of Pulse of Mirage. On turn 9, I had something like 3 lands on the battlefield, and the opponent played Turn of the Black Rose on turn 4. And they wasn't still able to kill me. Pulse of Mirage, Trons are really good. Angler Delver is a strange deck right now, because there's not a really good shell list. There's not a really good list, so probably it's still a good matchup for Tron. The Angler Delver is not the same deck as before the gash ban. Burrow's Bully is literally a buy for Tron, for Tron, because if I'm able to resolve a Relic of Progenitus or maybe one or two copies of Pyroblast they may have, they actually can't kill me. They can also resolve a Palace Sentinel on turn 4, but hey, if I draw more cards than you, if I add enough mana, I can kill you. There's no real problem.
And thanks to AdeptoTerra. We're going to hear just a little bit more from him later when we cover our weekly segments. But due to structural logistics, we're going to move in to a conversation now with Modern Monkey, the winner of last week's challenge. I want to welcome you back to the Pauper Players Podcast.
Hello, Fursile. I am really happy to be back. I hope we can discuss something about the meta and about yesterday's challenge. I know you already had Adepto here. I just want to say something about him because we are friends here in Italy. We belong to the same community. And what's funny is that we always disagree about everything, about card choices, about deck lists, about basically everything. And I want to also say that he has a nickname in our community, which is Taunting Elf, because he actually behaves like a little taunting elf. But I'm just joking, he's a very good player and a great person, so we are friends. We don't live in the same city, but we often meet at tournaments and we keep in touch via chat. So,
yeah, let's start with your challenge finish. On Sunday, you won the challenge. Was not the first time. It's the second time that I know about you winning the challenge. Take me through your tournament. What did you play against?
Well, Frusai, you know everything about challenges. You know my results better than me, so thank you. Yes, I already won one back when Delver, Blue Black Delver was legal in the format. And winning again with Tron, it makes me happy, but also a bit sad because we don't have any more Delver decks in the format. But yesterday was a very good challenge. Actually, I'm pretty happy about my plays. And I must say that I played what I think is the best deck right now, which is Tron. My list and Adepto list are a bit different, because I know he's all in on Stone Orbs while I am on the Fog plane. That's because I think that Fog plane is better with the mana base you're running, because going for Stone Orb makes you running a strange mana base with too many taplands and requires too many colors. So I am on Moment's Peace. Actually, my challenge started with a big boss, because I played the first match against Dissonance. As always, he's on Stompy, and by the way, I would really like to hear him on this podcast, as I already told you, and I hope he listens to this podcast, and maybe one day he will come, because I think he's one of the best players in the Pauper scene. And I managed to win the game 2-1, and of course I think he played super well, and he was able to steal a game because he had a long bow in the sideboard. But Tron is really favorite against Stompy. It's a very, very easy matchup if your cards come together fine. Not so much to say about this when you have your lock going, he can't do much except killing you on turn 4. Then the second match, I played against a really, really strange deck, which is Mono Blue, freed from the real combo. I know the community loves this deck. And it was really interesting, and I don't remember the name of the pilot, but it was really good, I think. I managed to win 2-0, but this is a very, very hard matchup, because they play like 3 or 4 Giga draws, which is not good when you're playing so few blue sources. I want to say something about this matchup, because the way you win these kind of matches is that you have to know how to play against combo decks. In some way, this reminded me of the tribe matchup. I'll explain better now. So I had my Tron ready and like 4 blue sources. The way you play this matchup is you don't wait for him to go on the combo. I had a couple of counters in my hand, and I started to counter basically everything he played to make him difficult to set up his combo. In these matches, if you are too passive and you just wait until you can counter the big combo piece, which is just freed from the real in this matchup, you will probably lose, because they can just gigadross you in the end of turn. And about this, this is one of the most important lessons in playing Magic and playing tempo, actually. This is, you have to use your mana in a very efficient way. If you have counters in hand, it's not always correct to counter the big spell. Sometimes it's better to use your counter when you can, so that you can play with your mana, especially in Tron. Sometimes you have just 3 or 4 colored mana, and that it really limits what you can do. Sometimes you have to catch that spot, use your spells, and then go on with your game plan. If you just wait until the opponent can set up, you often lose. It's not easy. It's really not easy. It's hard to read the situation and knowing when to tap out, when to counter, when to keep the counter in hand. But I think it's really, really important. And this also applies when you play tempo decks, especially with the Delver decks. You can't waste your mana, waste your turns. You sometimes have to just counter the opponent's spell and go ahead with your game plan. So we are going to the third match. I met Blue-Black Delver from Diego Brando. He is really a kind player. I'm happy when I meet him, because we always have good chatting in the chat. And this brought back some good memories about Blue-Black Delver times. Of course, this list is it's not what it used to be, but he defeated me. He had two very good starts, and I had just one good start. So Double Delver is something that still kills Tron. Even when you have pieces and Tron ready, managing to play against a Double Delver is hard. And I think he made good use of his counters. I still think Tron is favored, as it was back in the days. I know people disagree and think that Tron is was unfavored against Delver, but for me, Tron has always been favored against Blue-Black Delver, if Tron player, of course, knew what he was doing. So, match 4, I met the boss himself. I met Elsau on his Tron list, and I won 2-0. Game 1, well, I think my list is heavily favored. He has, if I remember correctly, like 7 or 8 pieces or Foggy Effect main deck. I think I have 3. Or four if you count the Weather the Storm. So of course my list has a better game 1. And game 2, I could lock him. You know, when you have your wall going and you can just get back a Pyroblast a turn, and that's good game against the mirror. By the way, I strongly support him when he says that the Tron mirror is obscene. It's just a very, very boring match, and you win if you close the Tron before your opponent. If you don't, there is not much you can do. So match 4, I met Stompy again. Not much to say about this match, because again, it was Stompy. If your cards come together, you usually win the matchup. Game 6, it was against the Boros Bully. Again, an easy matchup. You just have to be wary of the... I can't remember. Already the Peasant, that's a card. I couldn't remember the name. Sometimes they just steal the win. And Flaring Pain after the sideboard. But it's a good matchup. Last game, it was my win and in. I met Bar. Bar is not an easy matchup, especially if they start with creatures like Thermo Alchemist, also posts a board. They played the Archer, which really doesn't make your game easy. But whether the Stormwind deck did a huge work, I strongly advise you to run this card main deck, because it completely changes the matchup. It's not easy. If you weather the storm deck for like 6, they usually are dead. So I qualified for top 8 finally, because I had a bad round for the last challenges. Like I always came 9. And finally I could make top 8. And in the first match of the top 8, I met again Bully from STI. He's a good player, but the matchup is so lopsided. I just want to spend some word on these games, because I think that this presented a really good game situation. So we were in game 2. I won game 1. He had a pretty good race. He managed to bring me to like 3 life. So at one point he had just one card in hand, and I had to read that that card was Lightning Bolt. So I had to play my game around it, because I had a flicker in hand and a wall on the board, but no other interactions. I had to wait until I could find other interaction and play around it, because if I played Flicker before he botted me, he could have just killed me in response. So I had to play around it. What is important is in this situation is that if your opponent has a card in hand and he didn't play it, or he is not playing it for a few turns, you have sometimes to make the read and just try to think what that card could be. If Bully doesn't play a card against Tron, either is a Pyroblast, but I mean, they would probably counter the wall, or it's a Bolt, and they're waiting for you to tap out and just kill you. Then in the semifinals, Bolt kept hunting me because I met Barn again. Again, Weather and Storm did a huge work here in game one. And game two, that's funny because in my sideboard, I was playing a single Fireball. And that's not for the meme. Oh, well, it's for the meme, but also it's a card that I think is important because you side it against Pestilence, for example, or midrange decks. It's just another win condition that you just play and win. In this case, I could side it against Burn because they played Thermo Alchemist, the Gitu, the Archer, and fireballing an Archer for one was very, very fun. Then the last game was the final. Of course, I met Boros Monarch. Again, here not so much to say. He stumbled a bit, and I was able to quickly run over the game.
I would really like to know what is up with that fireball in your sideboard.
Okay, well, you know, Tron used to run Rolling Thunder, but in my list I play just two Cable Temptations and Simic Signet, and four, of course, Prism. And you don't have too many red sources when you look at the deck list, and this is also why in the sideboard you just play a couple of Pyroblast. I would really love to play four Pyroblast, but I can't, because my mana base can't support it. I know other lists, like Hellsouth list, play 4 Pyros, but they also play 4 Caves. They have more colored mana, but Cave is low. It's like you play a turn slower with Cave. I don't think it's correct, or at least I don't like it. It can be correct if you build around it, of course. So assuming this, I wanted something in the sideboard to side against matchups that can grind you. This is the reason because I have also Ulamog in my sideboard. In some matches you can't loop really effectively with Flicker because you have to go through Relic of Progenitus, Bojuka Bog, Korsky Fisher on Bojuka Bog, and then Pyroblast, and then every other 8 cards. So I want an easy way to win or run out to those situations. Fireball is an out, and it only is one red mana, so my mana base can support it, I think. Yes, it's true that the Rolling Thunder can be played in late game, but for example, Fireball can be sided against Bard. Against Bard, you can't bring in Rolling Thunder because you don't have double red in early game, but Fireball, this is fine. Fireball is a nice card. And the other card that was unusual in my sideboard was Unwind, a singleton Unwind, which I copied from AdeptoTerra. I know he loves Unwind. It was great. Unwind could be a dispel, but I wanted some cards against midrange decks. Unwind is a good sideboard choice against Pestilence, for example, or Random Combo, or whatever. Or Bar. It's better than dispel in the Bar matchup. So that was my choice. I hope I could answer your question.
Did you kill anyone with that fireball?
An archer. A Barn archer, actually, for one. But it was fundamental. It was my dream. Killing someone with Fireball in the challenge was my dream, but I could not, sadly. Next challenge, we can kill someone with Fireball.
You mentioned wanting to discuss card advantage in Pauper, and what's a counter versus known archetypes. Can you expand on that subject?
Okay, so Unwind is not the only 3 mana cost counter I have in my deck, because I also play main deck a singleton Exclude. This card is not played much in Tron in these days, but I think it's really, really important because it allows you to counter the Monarch on turn 4. And Monarch is one of the reasons you lose against the Boros and against Pestilence. It's just like the only reason that you lose to these matchups. You don't lose if they are not Monarch. So I think that playing this exclude and denying your opponent their card advantage is great. I would like to start from here and take my talking a bit further and talking about card advantage in Pauper, and especially which cards you are supposed to counter in some matchups. Because I see really many people, especially in leagues, playing blue-based decks and countering the wrong stuff. I said before that sometimes you have to spend your counter if you are choked on mana. But this doesn't mean that you have to throw your counters away. We know counterspells are some of the best cards in Pauper, and having counterspell is an insurance on your game situation. So you have to play them really carefully. The main mistake I see people making in Pauper is playing counterspell on removal spells. Like you are playing a Delver deck. Let's say you play a Delver deck, blue red fairies, for example, against Boros. You go turn one, land Delver, okay? They go for their top lands and their nonsense prism into core into whatever stuff. And sometimes they bolt your Delver. And let's say they are 10 life, and you start a counter war on that bolt. Well, for me, this is completely wrong, because this means that you are not understanding how that matchup is working. Of course, if you are racing and racing is the only way you have to win, you counter that bolt. But in most situations, you don't, because the matchup is played around card advantage. And if they bolt your threat, they're just making a 1/1. If you start a counter on that bolt, then the next turn can play Korskite Fisher into prison, and then Korskite Fisher into something else, and so on, and they start to snowball, and you lose the game. So in matchups like Boros, you keep your counterspell for essentially 10 cards, 11 cards, which are Glintoaks, Korskite Fishers, and Palace Sentinels. And that's it, actually. So let's take another deck, Mono Black. Mono Black, against Mono Black, you can't counter their removal spells, because, I mean, they are a deck full of removal spells, so you really don't win if you counter all of them, you can't. But let's make another example, okay? Old Blue-Black Delver against Mono Black. I saw a lot of people countering, like, a Chainer's Edict on a Gurmagangler. For me, again, if you're racing, this is different, but it has no point. The matchup is again on card advantage. Your most important card in that matchup is Augur of Bolas and, of course, Stormbound Geist. You are not winning with Gurmagangler. You are not winning with Delver. You keep your counterspell for their threats, and this is because your late game cards are more powerful than their late game cards. You have card advantage, which was Gash, was Brainstorm, was Preordain, and they had not. They had just like a Sanguine Blood, and that is a card you can counter. Grey Merchant is a card you can counter because it swings the game and gives them so much tempo they can work with. Monarch is the must counter card in that matchup. But Pauper is not like Legacy. You don't usually win by running a single threat to the finish line. Black Delver back in the past was not a Protect the Queen deck like many people think it is. It was a mid-range deck that could also play tempo against Tron. That is a different beast. I mean, Tron is not Mono Black. Against Tron, you fight on removal, but against Mono Black, you don't. Also, again, against Elves, I am just reading MTG Goldfish page here with the most common matchups. Against Elves, you don't go countering like Quirion Ranger or Mana Dork. You save your counters for the most important cards in the matchup, which are Lissalana, Timberwatch, and Distant Melody, the Stampede, Weather the Storm. This is my talking here is just that it's really important to identify which cards are the most important in the matchup and fight for them if you're playing counters, not fighting on everything. Pauper is a game, is a format of card advantage. Basically, every card that is played in Pauper, if it's not an aggro card, has some form of card advantage inherent to it. Say, Korskite Fisher is card advantage, Pestilential Sprite, Ninja, Chittering Rats, Thermo Alchemist is card advantage in the sense that you don't use bolts on opponent, you just tap your Thermo Alchemist. Pauper is a card advantage format, you can't waste your counter. You have to grind your opponent until the finish line. And this is also why I played Unwind in the sideboard, because It's a great counter and also gives you mana advantage.
Can you expand on why you play three remote isles?
Oh, this is a very, very nice question. I play three remote isles because I think it's a great card. This is a trivial answer, I know. No, it's just that after the Astral ban, which by the way, it's fine, but the problem with Pauper ban start way before Astral. I strongly support the fact that Dates and Gash should not have been banned, because by banning them, we just allowed Tron to be the dominant deck. I think Tron has no bad matchups today. So if you want to win, it's stupid. Do not play Tron. I mean, maybe you can play Monarch and be lucky in the pairings, but really Tron is the best deck now. They ban Gash, and there is no Tribe, no Delver, no Blitz, no Exit Blitz, so no bad matchups for Tron. Back to the question. After Astral, you have to play more dead cards, which are Signets. I think that playing Signets is correct, because they speed up your game. With Signet, you can play a turn faster and have more colored mana. But Signet is also a dead card, or a card that does not cantrip. It's a card disadvantage. So for this reason, I play in three isle, because I don't want to flood, because flooding with this list is worse than flooding with a older list. Also, I have four maps. Sometimes you just draw a map. If you have three isle in your deck, you can tutor them, and map is no longer a dead card. It's just a card that cycles, but you know, you have a billion mana. Moreover, they are a blue source. Many times you just start the game by playing remote isle. Okay, it's tapped, turn one, doesn't make any difference. And if you draw it in the late game, it's not a dead card. While otherwise, if you start the game with a Cave of Temptation that you might be playing in place of Remote Isle, well, you are playing one turn slower. I play for Impulse in my list. If I played Cave, I could play Impulse only on turn 3. With Remote Isle, I can go Remote Isle and then untap land and then play. While if I draw Remote Isle in the late game, well, that card cycles, so I have another good draw, maybe. That's it.
Did the snow-covered islands play well with your Simic Signets?
Snow-covered island was a great card in the deck. It's not covered only for a nostalgia reason. They could be easily island. But I think that having a good number of untapped sources of mana, and especially blue sources, is crucial. And also, they allow you to go turn one, turn two, island into Signet, and then you have more mana, more colored mana, and I think you need untapped mana in this format. Of course, playing with gain lands, well, it gives you more stability, more stability with colors especially, and the life gain can be crucial in sometimes, but I'm still pretty sure that having untapped mana is important. Again, if you play island or snow covered island, you play Signet, and then you need to play cycle lands, because you have many more that drops in your deck. You have like half your deck is mana. In the late game, you need to find a lock, or your deck is not working. So having three cycle lands really helped me finding my spells.
Now it's time for the play of the day. What was your play of the day, Modern Monkey?
Oh, my play of the day, as I said, I think it was against STI in the semifinals. It was on reading he had the bolt in hand and playing my cards accordingly. At some point, I had the lock going. I had a wall, a prism, and a drifter, if I remember correctly. In the graveyard, also, I had a condescend and a prohibit in hand. So, a turn, I flickered wall and prism. Because, of course, I didn't have a Mad Drifter, now I remembered. I flickered one the Prism, and I got back my Condescend, and not my Flicker. That was a bit riskier. I could just start drawing bad cards, but my top deck is way better than his top deck. And I knew he had Bolt in hand, so by taking Condescend, I could start playing my cards without a fear of being bolted, because I was a true life. And I think this was my play of the day, and this allowed me to reach the finals.
How about you, AdeptoTerra? What was your play of the day?
My play of the day? Okay, so on Sunday, my best play probably was casting a lot of Pulse of Mirasa against Ponza, against Burrows Bully. Steve's Burrows Bully list had 4 copies of Stone Rain on the sideboard, and on game 3, they Stone Rained a land on turn 3, and on turn 4, and then on turn 5 they played Palace Sentinel, but thanks to Palace of Mirasa, I was still able to return in game and win the match. I think probably Pulse of Mirasa was the best card in the entire Pauper challenge for me.
I had the opportunity to play the challenge this week as well. I tied myself for the worst performance I've ever had in the challenge at 1-3 drop with the same blue-red Delver list that can be found in the 5-0 published lists this week. Literally got the 5-0 earlier that morning. My luck turned against me. I had a lot of mulligan to fives, some bad matchups, some blowouts. My play of the day is stacking a ponder correctly. Just straight up, that's the only thing I did that was good. Kind of a cop-out, I know, but hey, I flipped that Delver's secrets. Let's focus a little more instead on some silly Sliver's abilities. Because I did so very poorly in the challenge this week, my ability this week is all Slivers have a sneaking suspicion that they would have been a better deck choice. How about you guys? What are your silly Sliver abilities?
Well, my silly Sliver ability for the week is tap 3 Slivers with different name, and you can add 7 colorless mana to your mana pool and play whatever you want.
Tron Sliver.
Let's hope they don't ban the Slivers for this.
My Slivers is any Slivers you control have the ability to tap or untap another Sliver. Because I really like creatures combo deck in Pauper and blinking or tapping or untapping. It reminds me of Kiron Ranger, one of my favorite cards. I am a very fanatic of the Elves archetypes.
Well, thank you so much for joining us back on the podcast, Modern Monkey. And AdeptoTerra, it was a pleasure having you here for the first time. Something tells me it won't be the last.
Thank you, Frusai, for inviting me again on your podcast. I still think that what you do for the community is great, and this place is it's fantastic because players can discuss, and I always listen to it with pleasure. So again, thanks for inviting me, and see you soon, maybe.
Goodbye. Thank you for having me here. It was a pleasure.
And thanks so much to my guests for coming on the podcast this week. It was a very interesting discussion. I would never have guessed that you bring in Ulamog's Crusher against Boros Monarch. I thought that was only for the Tron Mirror. Reign of Revelation makes perfect sense. Unwind, very interesting. They're a step ahead in some ways. They have cards in their sideboard that dodge the cards in your sideboard. Most people are bringing in Graveyard Hate, Dispels, Red Elemental Blast. That is the standard shopping list against Tron. Crusher, Fireball, care not for these solutions. Since dominating the challenge, Adepto has added 2 lone missionaries to his sideboard, cutting an Electricary and a Weather the Storm. So anyone looking to play his list should consider making these adjustments as well. A note to end on this week. We've spoken with Tron pilots for the past 2 weeks, so even if it wins the challenge for a third consecutive week, I am going to talk to someone else shaping the metagame. I feel like we've covered Tron on the podcast just about as much as we can. So let's cover something completely different. And I'll see you then.